olhar à volta, entender o porquê das forças da natureza. Esse era um princípio fundamental de Albert Einstein. Muito se fala sobre Einstein. Muitas histórias são atribuídas a ele. O Arquivo N conversou com um biógrafo de Einstein, John Stachel, para entender os caminhos desse homem que mexeu com a história da humanidade. Bom, estamos falando de um homem que nasceu no século retrasado, em Ulm, na Alemanha. O ano era 1879. O ano de 2005 lembra duas vezes Einstein. Seu cinquentenário de morte e ainda a comemoração dos 100 anos do clique. Daquele momento em que todas as peças se encaixaram. O que ele chamou de teoria da relatividade restrita. E acredite, Einstein tinha apenas 26 anos.
É often the case with people of great talent that they sort of have an apprenticeship when they do good work but nothing outstanding. And then suddenly something clicks and the great leap forward, as they would say in China, takes place. A great change in their work happens. Happened, for example, with Balzac. He wrote many novels as a young man, which were not particularly distinguished, and he later wouldn't have them republished because he was not proud of them. Then suddenly came the click, then he started to work, you know, produce the great series, La Comédie Humaine. With Einstein, something similar. His early works are acceptable. They were accepted by the Annales de Physique, which was the leading physics journal of that time, but they were not exceptional. If you just looked at those works, you would say, okay, it's a reasonably talented young man, but nothing special. But then in 1905, everything seemed so fitted together, and he took off, so to speak, and after that, there was no stopping. So from a patent office clerk, within a couple of years, he got a job in the university as assistant professor, then full professor, then he's invited to Berlin to be a member of the Academy of Sciences, with the right to teach, but no obligation to teach, just to devote himself to research completely. This all happens within the space of 8 years after 1905, that he rises like a meteor. He developed childhood, adolescence. In many ways, it was difficult adolescence. His family was in the electrotechnical business, which at that time was one of the most advanced technological frontiers, maybe like computers today. But the family business failed finally in Munich, and the family moved to northern Italy to try to start business again and had more problems and failures there. So they actually couldn't support him when he went to university. And relatives had to support him. He was a very self-possessed person, very strong sense of inner confidence, I think. And this often gave people the impression that he was arrogant, cheeky, we would say.
He was not.
He was. Oh, yes.
He was.
Oh, yes. For example, once when he was in a secondary school and his geology professor asked him, a professor whom he liked, asked him to look at the strata of the rocks and say which way they run chronologically, from up to down or down to up. And he says, it's all the same to me, Professor.
Simplicity was the way of the man himself at Kaput, his house in the lake area outside Berlin. He was followed here by politicians and academics, like the American physicist who took these home movies. But here he could sail, think, lounge with friends. The informality became part of the legend.
He was always looking at the foundational problems. He could do the detailed studies of this or that problem, but he did it like you and I would do a crossword puzzle. It was like an amusing thing. But for him, the important problem is, how is the world constructed? What is the deeper underlying nature of the laws of physics? That was his deepest work, was always concerned with that, those kind of problems.
Ele insistiu sobre o fato que não é a ciência que vai nos dizer que o bem, que o mal. Não é a ciência que vai nos dizer que são os valores. Não é na ciência que você vai encontrar a ideia de liberdade ou a ideia de amor. Só que se você quer fazer ciência, você tem que ter a mente levada por essas ideias. Você não vai fazer ciência se você não está procurando a verdade, por exemplo. Mas a ideia de procurar a verdade, não você, a ciência não vai dizer. A ciência não vai, na sua pesquisa, descobrir que nós temos que procurar a verdade. Esta é uma colocação que pré-existe ao fato de querer fazer ciência.
There are several biographies about Albert Einstein. Some claim he started to speak quite late and he was a mediocre student. Is that true or false?
It's false.
It's false.
Yes. He started to speak a little late, but not that much beyond the normal.
And how old was he?
Between 2 and 3. And he had a peculiar habit, which he later described to someone, that he would form a sentence in his own mind and say it, he thought, whisper it to himself. And then if he was happy with it, he would say it out loud. But, of course, what he thought was whispering was heard by people. So the family maid called him the dope at that time. She thought there was something wrong with him because he repeated the sentences twice, but he was actually just testing it out for himself. And he spoke quite well once he did speak. In fact, there's a letter which his mother tells her mother about what his cute sayings at that time. So it's a legend that he was a dyslexic or something like that. After he started to speak, his speech development was very normal.
And as a student?
As a student, he was very good in the subject he was interested in, mathematics and physics, but he wanted to do things slowly, methodically, in his way. He was not interested in quick answers.
In your opinion, which was Einstein's greatest quality? His stubbornness, his curiosity, his intuition, all of the three together?
Well, he said stubbornness. Someone asked him once why he was so creative. He said, I'm not so creative, I'm just stubborn. In the sense that he started thinking about the idea, what would happen if you chased a light ray? He started thinking at 16 years old of this question. What would happen? Could you run as fast as the light ray? Could you catch up with it? Would it appear to stand still if it did? So many, many adolescents could think about such a question, but Einstein thought about it, continued to think about it, and productively, not just spinning his wheels, so to speak, thought about it productively, and he saw it, in retrospect, that was the beginning of his work on the special theory of relativity, 10 years later, completed. So 10 years to work on special relativity. Then in 1907, he started to think about the relationship between gravitation and special relativity. And he soon decided that there's no way to fit gravitation into the special theory of relativity. The theory must be generalized. And he worked on that for almost 10 years. He didn't complete the general theory of relativity till the end of 1915. So again, he was able to think long and hard about a problem over many years, where other people might think for a little while and give up. And of course, he worked on the idea of unified field theory to unite electromagnetism and gravitation for the last 35 years of his life without ever being satisfied himself with the result. But he said, he had a wonderful saying, which I think sums up his attitude. He and another physicist were discussing a third physicist who was not considered very good by most physicists. And Einstein said, on the contrary, he thought very much of this man, because early in his life, he had found some important problems to work on, and he continued to work on them, whether he was successful or not. And Einstein said, I don't think much of a carpenter who, if he has to bore a hole in a piece of wood, looks for the thin spot. You bore the hole where it's needed, not where it's easy to do. that sort of sums up his approach.
There was a conflict in his mind. Could a pacifist commit himself to a military struggle against fascism